Good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining us on Greater Dayton Live. I'm DATV Executive Director Steve Ross, and tonight we're talking with some folks from 97.3 WSWO. WSWO is the low-power community radio station run by all volunteer staff in Huber Heights. Joining me tonight are, on my immediate left, WSWO Chief Engineer Zack Riepenhoff.
Riepenhoff,
thank you. And across from me is WSWO Program Director Tony Peters.
That's me. Good to be here.
And Community Affairs Director for WSWO, Shelly Hulce.
Thanks for having us.
Well, I appreciate you guys showing up tonight. The first thing I have to mention tonight is, besides your aforementioned titles at WSWO, each one of you are the radio personalities there. And you all do different types of work, on-air work for the radio station. And again, as I mentioned in the intro, it's all volunteer staff. Can you guys tell me more about WSWO? First of all, I listen to it religiously. I love it.
Good. That's good to hear.
I hear songs on that station that I literally have not heard since I was a little kid, and I just absolutely love it. Plus, it's a variety of songs, old songs. So, Tony, you're the program director. How about starting us off and tell us a little bit more about WSWO?
Sure. WSWO, we affectionately are known as Oldies 97.3 as well. That's our moniker. And our format is a lot of stuff you don't get anywhere else. 50s, 60s, and 70s. It's crazy if you think about it that oldies now is 80s on most of the big radio stations. And so we kind of like to think about what we do as music preservation. You know, I mean, we're the only place in Dayton that you can get Elvis Presley anymore, or the Beatles, or the Beach Boys, the Four Seasons, all the great Motown stuff. So that's really what we pride ourselves on, is keeping a lot of this great music alive. And we have a devoted listener base that is definitely supports what we do as well.
So how did WSWO come about?
I think that would be Zach you'd want to talk to.
Really?
There, I think.
Okay.
Yes.
He's one of the founders.
Oh. Yeah, going back to the very beginning, I was right after, I guess, when it all started. Back in about the year 2000, the FCC began looking at the media landscape and saying, we've got too much consolidation and there's not a lot of local voices out there post Telecom Act of 96, when all of this giant corporate radio groups, they all got started. And so they decided to establish this class that they called Low Power FM. And there was a lot of back and forth on what the regulations would be. And what we wound up with was a service that would be owned by nonprofit organizations, operated 100 watts, have a coverage area of about 4 to 5 mile radius, or about, 4 or 5 kilometers, actually, about 3.5 to 4 miles, and be a non-commercial service that would serve local communities.
So now, when did you say that you guys started transmitting?
We're what I would call, I guess, a first window station, because there were two windows so far to apply. And the first one was in 2000, and it took, I believe, 1.5 to 2 years before the application was initially approved. And from there, the station was finally constructed and went on the air in September of 2004.
Oh, wow. So I mentioned that you were in Huber Heights. Where is your transmitter located?
It's been in a couple different places. Right now, it's on a former cable company head end at the corner of Needmore Road and Old Troy. So it's actually on the border of Dayton and Huber Heights, located at the Tri-Cities wastewater plant there. We're about 145 feet up off the ground at that site. We get a good view into downtown and a good view back the other direction into Huber Heights.
So I'm interested in the technical end of it. How do you get your signal from your station in Huber Heights over to that spot?
We use a system I call an STL, or a studio to transmitter link. It's actually a microwave signal that operates at about 950 megahertz. It's just a watt, but we don't have far to go. We only have about a 2.5 mile path, and it goes directly from the studio to the transmitter, and it gets our audio and our programming from our site on Chambersburg Road, where we're located in the Huber Center, down to the tower on Needmore Road.
So WSWO is a community radio station, and as I said, it's all volunteer run and operated. How did you folks get involved with it?
Well, like anyone else, I picked it up in my car, and this was 2009. Couldn't get it in my house, but I could get it in my car. And so I kept, you know, dialing it in and started talking to someone at work about it. And unbeknownst to me, he was a volunteer. And he said, you should come out and look at it, and, you know, see, meet everybody and see what we do. And I was hooked. So I asked if I could train and be a volunteer. So like everyone else that comes by, we, you know, no matter what background you bring with you, you sit down and train in our system and learn our format and our policies and things like that we have to follow according to our nonprofit regulations and FCC regulations and things like that. So I think Tony came to a record sale and met everybody, and then he came over. And but Zach, I think maybe an interesting story you could tell is exactly how we started in the little storage room. That's a great story.
Very humble beginnings. Yeah, the regulations were much tighter initially when the station was started, and the only place it would fit per the FCC was north of Interstate 70, and so it was located on a telephone pole at a self-storage facility with the equipment in a closet and no studio at the time. So once a week, somebody would go up there with a memory stick and update the programming for the week on the computer, and it would sit there and run. The antenna was on top of a telephone pole, and we ran a telephone line in there. Someone would drive up and patch the phone line in to get Wayne High School football on the air, go down to the stadium, and then come back in about the third or beginning of the fourth quarter and be ready to disconnect the telephone line from the ball game when it was over.
Wow. You know, that's sort of the humble beginnings of DATV.
Right.
We will be in existence for 40 years next year.
Wow, that's great.
But we started out in the White House that's on the Theological Seminary off of Salem Avenue.
Mm-hmm.
And so that literally was a closet, basically, access center. And that's really sort of the story behind how you guys got started. Now, you mentioned how you became interested. Had you done radio before?
Yes, I had volunteered at WYSO. And I think that's about how everyone in this area has started.
Another good radio station.
Yes, public radio. They're affiliated with Antioch College. So I had friends there, and I just started training. And then they asked, "Do you want to learn how to do this? Do you want to learn how to do that?" And I just stuck with it. But then when I heard WSWO, I said, "Oh, this is all music," which I was more interested in. And so everyone here, or everyone at our station, is a music lover. And that's another thing that sets us apart, that this station is programmed and run by music lovers. We don't have any commercial entities or labels to please. We do have support from the community, both individuals and businesses. But we run this strictly from support from the community. We're a nonprofit, so donations to us are tax deductible, and we work within the community to support mostly Wayne High School, the school district. As a community radio station, that is our biggest focus on supporting Wayne athletes. Okay. And boy, do we. The Wainiacs, as they call them.
I listen to the games.
They're loyal listeners. And when the last 2 years, the football team has gone to state championships, Zach has had to up our streaming capacity over and over and over. This costs money, and we've had some good folks step up to the bat and provide more monetary donations to keep that going. So we support the school district. School district is good for the community, and we also attend fish fries and fundraisers to help the school district as well.
So I want to bring Tony into this conversation because Tony and I have met, this is like the second time, but I recognize the name and I recognize the voice from another, a past life, I think.
Long ago and far away, right?
A different local right. radio station.
Yes, that's true. Yeah, I used to work for about 10 years for WTUE 104.7. And so, you know, that was my full-time job for, 6 days a week or almost, throughout just about most of the 90s. And as Zach mentioned, the telecommunications bill of 1996, I would encourage anybody that if you've not heard of this piece of legislation, I think it's one of the most important pieces of legislation in the last 50 years because it completely changed the landscape of really our life as Americans. Because if you think about media, you know, that we use every day, whether it be television or radio or newspapers or the internet or any number of these things, cable TV, any of this, this was affected. Telephone, this was all affected by this this bill. And when this bill came along, it pretty much relaxed all the regulations on media ownership. And a few years after that happened, the radio station I was working for, their big parent company came along and just started buying other radio stations up. And eventually, it's kind of how it is in modern day sort of commercial radio, is most of it is automated. Most of it is run by a computer and has very little local element. So I lost my job in 1999 and was out of radio for a good while. And then I happened to have actually my old boss at WTUE, who had kind of moved on and done other things, had sent me an email and says, I kind of wonder why you're not involved with this radio station. And it was kind of sort of on my radar, but that was kind of the spark that was needed for me to, I reached out, and just as everybody else has done, you reach out, and they run you through a training program to make sure you know how to run the software and the controls and that sort of thing. And I became a volunteer, and that's how I got involved. So,
well, the one thing I do like about what you're doing, and for those who don't know, or for those who listen to WSWO, this is Glad Girl across from me, and she does deep tracks, and she'll be doing a show on later. Well, it's Tuesday nights, 9 to midnight.
Yep.
But not only do you play music, but you host Sunday Conversation.
Where
you talk to different people in the industry, have been around the industry for years. Tell us a little bit about that. That's got to be kind of a tough thing to set up and get people involved with, I would
think. Well, I run a website on the internet called iconfetch.com, and it was something, again, kind of as a stopgap in between my radio career. I got the itch to sort of do some kind of radio, and at the time I didn't have an outlet for it, and so I got into podcasting. And so with this Icon Fetch website, I just started reaching out to people and going, hey, would you like to do an interview? And once you have a couple of interviews up on the internet, then that's your legitimacy. And then I started to get people to say yes. My very first interview was Tommy James of Tommy
wow.
James and the Shondells.
Yeah.
And he was phenomenal. And he said yes. I reached out to him and he said yes. And so from there, I got Darlene Love. I interviewed Solomon Burke before he passed away, the soul singer. And when you have a couple of these heavy hitters, and that's what people see when they come to your website, then it became easier to sort of book other guests. And so for now, as you do things, I was kind of, I guess, naive. I thought that when you reached out to somebody, say Darlene Love, well, they have their own press person, and that person is just that Darlene Love's
right.
press person. No, they have a whole slew of other clients. And so as I interview one person, then as soon as that interview's over, I get an email from the PR person going, well, I've got these couple of people. Who do you, would you like to interview them? And so it's a constant sort of thing where I'm juggling. Now I've got a relationship with several PR agencies that will then just sort of send me people. And so I just interviewed John Mayall, British blues guy that helped Eric Clapton kind of jumpstart his career. Guy's 83 years old. I just interviewed him last week, and that was like the latest one that we did on the Sunday Night Conversation. So what I've done with the Icon Fetch stuff is not everything I do on the Icon Fetch website is oldies related. Like, I just interviewed a lady today named Ruthie Foster that's a great kind of folk blues singer, but that's not something that would really pertain to oldies, so that'll be one that'll just be on the website. But the ones that actually are 50s, 60s, and 70s artists, those are the ones that I'll put on the Sunday Night Conversation show. So that's where that came from.
And they're very interesting shows.
Well, I appreciate it.
I listen to them.
I'm glad that some people are listening. You never know. That's one of the things with radio.
Yeah.
With radio, it's interesting because, you know, you just don't know. You don't know who's listening at any given time. It's a very strange thing to sit in a room with a microphone and talk to people and hope people are listening. You know, that's one of those things about radio. So.
And I'm always amazed that when I give tours of DATV, the people who never heard about it or they've never watched it, they come in and I give them a tour. They're blown away by what's available for them here.
Oh, absolutely. It's great facilities, yeah.
So you're a nonprofit, so you take donations, but how else do you support yourself?
We do a major fundraiser, one major fundraiser a year, is where we bring the albums and 45s out of the store and lock that we collect throughout the year. We have listeners donate, or people who hear about it, they come and donate their albums and 45s, and we keep them stored away, and then we break them out, theoretically, once a year if our inventory is good, and have a weekend sale. And we average about, 6,000 to 8,000 pieces of vinyl. Mm. We'll do that for 2.5-3 days. People come from all over to buy records, and that's our solid fundraiser, but then we have the combined federal campaign that folks can do.
What is that?
You could explain that better because you head up that campaign.
Yeah, that's the for the base employees, mail carriers, and new this year, anybody on a government pension, a retiree, will be able to contribute. It's a pre-tax deduction out of your check.
Okay.
So it reduces your taxable income, and it passes through a centralized campaign. This year they've centralized it through the OPM office in D.C. They've made a lot of changes, but it allows federal retirees and active duty military, mail carriers, and government civilians, say those who work at Wright-Patt, to donate to us through payroll deduction and make a pledge and just have it withdrawn throughout the year from their paychecks and lower their taxable income.
Mm, very interesting. Yeah. So you're volunteer, so does that mean anybody can sign up to volunteer? And if so, you know, what if you get 100 people who say, oh, I want my own radio show? And, I mean, do you try to place them? Because I know a couple of people who would do really well at your station because they know a lot about music. I don't know as much about music as they do. But I'm sure there's probably a lot of different opportunities.
There are. We have an application process. Anyone's welcome to fill out an application, come up, take a tour, meet with Tony or one of the board members, and gauge their interest and their background and their availability. Is we like for people to be, you know, consistent. As far as getting your own show and that kind of thing, that's an inner thing that you enter into and then work with Tony as a program director and see how things go there. But we have so many people. We maintain about 30 volunteers?
Roughly, yeah.
Yeah. That they bring so many different backgrounds to the table. Everybody there has some kind of previous interest, at least. How old is Joe? He's 19, 18?
Yeah, we just got a new, he's recently graduated from high school, but he came in for a tour and he confessed to me that he doesn't like any of the music of his generation. He loves the 50s and 60s. And then he proceeded to talk my ear off about Eddie Cochran, stuff I didn't know. Yeah. I mean, it's amazing how this, you know, stuff on the internet you can find out. So yeah, our youngest volunteer is about 19, and then, you know, we've got guys well into their 70s.
Late 70s who were, you know.
Dr. Rock?
Right. Yeah.
Yes. Dr. Rock is on Tuesday morning.
We've got, you know, Vietnam era guys who, you know, this was their soundtrack. And so I like to say we're in the memory business.
Right.
Basically, because the 80s have not happened there yet and won't for a while, I'm sure. But as we provide music lovers that soundtrack, we're also getting younger people like Joe, who now, you know, in this technical age, they're discovering this stuff for the first time, and then we have other folks who are rediscovering. Right. So it's just a nice community of music lovers for all ages.
And as I said
it's
earlier,
family friendly too.
Yeah, and I have not, I mean, there were a ton of songs when I first started listening to the station I hadn't heard since I was a little kid. Mm-hmm. And I'm going, oh, who sings that? And you call it up and it's Hurricane Smith or it's Martin yeah. Hoople or right. somebody like yeah. that. And it's like, I completely forgot about that song.
Yeah, we touch every genre we can.
Well, that's the beauty of what we do is that we're not bound by, I mean, if you notice, if you listen to a commercial radio station, they have roughly between 300 and 500 songs and that's it. And they just play those over and over and over. And those are the tested songs. You know, those are the songs that they have done massive research on to make sure that these are the top songs that everybody wants right. to hear. And that's why, you know, you just, whatever, an artist like, say, Led Zeppelin, you only hear three songs anymore, even though Led Zeppelin had, you know, right. 50 or 60 songs, you know, whatever. And so what we look at is we take the decades of the 50s, 60s, and 70s, and if it hit the charts, someone in there, we'll play it in some sort of a rotation. You know, I mean, the lesser known hits are obviously going to come up in a slower rotation than some of the bigger ones. But that's kind of what we like. And it's amazing how many people we talk to on the phone that'll say, just like you said, you know, I haven't heard that song since I was in high school. And you just took me back to when I was in high school, you know, and we really are in the business of memories kind of thing. So,
and you know, when you listen to Glad Girl on Tuesday nights, she does deep tracks. So she'll grab an album, I guess, and just play like the ninth track on the album.
That's right.
Or whatever
yeah.
it is.
Right. I play the songs you did not buy the record for.
Right.
And it's really good listening. I mean, if you're
good
just,
songs too.
If you just want to listen and doodle or do whatever you're going to mm-hmm. do, and it's really good stuff.
Well, in the evening, most people are it's background music. Some are studying. Some are doing work around the house. And so these are folks who are just, you know, they have it in the background, but then something hits them and they go, oh man, mm-hmm. I don't remember that song, but you know, they'll go look in the albums they've got on their shelf and pull out that album.
You know, now one of the things we briefly talked about was that is also the sporting events that you guys cover. You know, it's mostly Wayne, but remember when you're doing Wayne, you're hitting all the other schools mm-hmm. around the area mm-hmm. as well. And I've listened to several of the games, football and some of the baseball, and it sounds to me as good as anything you're going to listen to. I mean, those guys do an excellent job covering that.
We do have a great sports team.
Now, the question is, since Zach is the chief engineer, do you have to show up for all those games?
Actually, it's kind of funny. I used to cover the games, and I ended up covering games in Greene County for another radio station, but I still get texts from them from time to time. You know, if they're having an issue or something, I'll answer it. But you mentioned the quality. That's one thing I think that we've come quite a ways in our ability to do remotes and ball games.
And how are you getting that signal back to the station?
We're actually using a 4G wireless hotspot mm-hmm. and an internet feed. We've got a special piece of equipment that's designed to work over the public internet and do so with as good reliability as possible and get a high quality feed. I mean, the same type of equipment, really, we're very fortunate. It's on the level of what a Division I level college broadcast wow. could be using. And so one thing that I always strive for in everything, and especially with the sports, is that we get the best quality feed and the best quality output from the station that we can. And well, we've really come a long way there.
And the one thing that I did want to follow up, and yeah, the technical quality is amazing, but the guys calling the games do an amazing job.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I don't know what their background.
Well, they love
their sports. Yeah, I don't know what their background is, or if most of them it was more on-the-job training with WSWO, but they're really good, and they're excited, and they're having a good time. And
you know, if you think about this, though, it's the same way with the music fans. You guys that are sports fanatics, and they're doing this because they love it. And so as volunteers, they're passionate about this, and they're doing it every week. And one of the things that I think is we've only been streaming maybe, what, 3-4 years, something like that?
Yeah, I think we've been streaming 4 or 5 years now.
And so what's great about that is that we will get texts from people that say, I'm stationed overseas, I'm listening to my alma mater now, or I'm stationed overseas, I can hear my son or my grandson or whatever, you know, nephew or whatever, play football or basketball or something. And how neat that is as a community service, that we are not only broadcasting the games over the FM transmitter, but then we're also streaming worldwide. And we've gotten texts from people in England and Germany. And didn't you get somebody in the International Space Station or something like that?
Oh, well, yeah, one night I was, as I normally do, we'll stream the International Space Station live through Ustream, and I just watch what they do. And sometimes they'll open up a chat. The crew will open up a chat. And so I saw that they opened up a chat when I was on the air, and I had that pulled up on the internet, and I said, and I told them, hey, I'm on the air, I'm on this station. Can I send you some songs? Of course, you know, I did a little Pink Floyd and David Bowie. And got a lot of, you know, thumbs up and smiley emojis back. So it's pretty neat. That was a fun experience.
That is neat.
Yeah.
So we can kind of touch people outside of, you know, the 100 watts that we reach
aliens.
In Beaver Heights and in aliens. Yeah.
So we're wrapping. It's getting close to our 30 minutes here, and it's been very quick. But if somebody wants to donate, if somebody wants to volunteer, what do they do? What's a website? What's a phone number?
Well, the website is DaytonOldies.org. That's a good place. We also have a business number, 723-1139. We'll put a 937 in front of that. Okay. And we don't have a receptionist. You know, we're a volunteer organization.
Voicemail.
So we have voicemail. But, you know, we check the voicemail on a regular basis. And so that's the best way. If somebody's interested in donating, if somebody's interested in becoming a volunteer, that's the gateway.
And real quick, we want to give a shout out to our sports director, Link Schreiber.
Yes.
He heads that up, and he's fantastic. And those guys travel to all those games.
Amazing.
No reimbursement for gas or babysitter.
Absolutely.
No nacho or pizza budget.
A pretzel with cheese.
Right. So, you know, so it's pay to play sometimes.
That's what I was trying to do, is give those guys a shout out. Mm-hmm. Well, listen, I really want to thank Zach, Tony, and Shelly for joining us tonight on Greater Dayton Live. Listen to 97.3. You're going to be glad you did. There's a lot of different types of music on there from the 50s, 60s, and 70s, and sometimes a little older when they do the big band show Saturdays.
Yep.
Like I said, you'll be glad you listened to them. And again, thank you to you for joining me.
Thanks for having us.
Absolutely. Thank you.
And thank you to everybody for joining us tonight. Good night.